Yeah, der Nancy Birdsall, der Mr. Kühnel, der Mr. Slay, der Arntraud, dear students, dear guests, there's a very long list tonight. It's a great pleasure for the Hertie School to host a Kapuscinski development lecture and to welcome Nancy Birdsall as a speaker tonight. This is the third time, in fact, the third Kapuscinski lecture that we're jointly hosting here at the school with the European Commission and the UN Development Programme, UNDP, and we're absolutely delighted that we have the privilege of doing so. Tonight's lecture is entitled "The New Middle Class in the Developing World, Does It Matter?" And I'm very much looking forward to hearing from Nancy Birdsall and later on also in the Q&A what the middle class in the developing world looks like and what effect they have on their respective countries' politics. You know, middle class, as I'm sure you're aware, is one of those terms that is used very, very often, very, very frequently. There's certainly the economics of the middle class, there's the sociology of the middle class, and there's the political science of the middle class. And we at the Hertie School, we started off as a school more within the OECD world, right? And we're slowly discovering that there's a world outside the OECD, if I may say so. There's a global south, and in the years to come, that will certainly be more of a focus here at the school. And within the OECD, if you think about it, there's such diverse conceptualization of what the middle class is, right? In the United States, I think 85% of the population think they're middle class. In the UK, if you're middle class, it tends to be slightly looked down upon, right? And in Germany, we know that we have a middle class, Mittelstand, and we're quite very proud of it, right? And it's nice to be part of that. Whereas in other countries, you would be, well, it's okay, right? But it could be different. Now, we know that Nancy is probably going to take more of an economic approach in analyzing the middle class, but perhaps in the Q&A, we can think about what some of the broader conceptualization around what it means to be in the middle class and what the politics of the middle class emerge from that might be. So let me just introduce Nancy and then also Arntraud, who is the moderator tonight. And Nancy is the founding president of the Center for Global Development, CDG. CDG is an independent, nonpartisan think tank in DC and also in London, focusing on how the policies of the richer countries impact on the developing nations across a range of areas, and in particular, the impact on poverty reduction and inequality. Prior to founding CDG, Nancy spent two decades in high-level positions, typically in research and finance, first the director of policy research at the World Bank, and before that, executive vice president of the Inter-American Development Bank. Her many publications include, and I love the title, Cash on Delivery, A New Approach to Foreign Aid, and New Ideas on Development After the Financial Crisis, which she co-edited with Frank Fukuyama, who is also no stranger to the Hertie School. She received her PhD in economics from Yale and an MA from Johns Hopkins and the School of Advanced International Studies there. So let me say a word about Arntraud. Arntraud Hartmann is a member of the Adjunct faculty at the Hertie School and at the Johns Hopkins University Bologna Center in Italy. She works as an independent consultant for the IMF, the World Bank, and GIZ, among many others. And she also worked for UNICEF, for the World Bank, and various other international organizations. She holds degrees in law, economics, and international relations from Hamburg University, but also from Johns Hopkins University and the American University, both in Washington, D.C. So allow me to pass the word to Richard Kühnle from the European Commission, and thank you again for coming tonight.
Thank you very much, Dean Anheier, Ms. Birdsall, Mr. Slay, ladies and gentlemen. The world has changed hugely in recent years. If you look into the media, you wouldn't believe it, but in many ways it has changed for the good and for the better. Emerging economies have burst onto the scene and are said to be the main generators of global economic growth by 2025. Extreme poverty is on the decline. Despite persisting problems and significant remaining pockets of poverty, on average, people across the globe live healthier, longer, better lives. Trade links have expanded. We have seen dramatic advances in communication and transport. Our world is richer, more connected, and more interdependent as a result. At the core of these developments is the emergence of a new middle class in the developing world, the topic of our today's discussion. Now, I would like to make three points. First, that the EU has something to do with it. Obviously, speaking for the Commission, I have to make our case. So I say that in many aspects, the European Commission played an important part in fostering this emergence. As many of you will know, Europe is the largest donor in development cooperation. Commission, together with member states, account for more than 50% of global development aid. However, the EU never acts alone. We believe in partnership and work in close coordination with our member states, with international organizations like the UNDP, NGOs, and with the support of academia and independent experts. Most importantly, we work in close partnership with stakeholders in the implementing countries, governments at all levels, local NGOs, civil society. Our work with the partners over the past decades provided the groundwork which allowed a new, stable middle class to prosper in many countries, which not long ago were considered to be in dire economic and political shape. What did we do? We invested in pillars of a stable society, improved health, education, especially for girls, infrastructure, political stability, democratic institutions, and trade access to EU markets, unilaterally, for example, for the poorest countries. These efforts bear fruit, and we see the emergence of these middle classes as confident citizens claiming their political rights and their political say. And that's, of course, also good for Europe and an element for Europe's prosperity. However, this welcome development also poses new challenges. What are the effects of middle-class aspirations, of consumerism, on the environment, on climate change, if you think of Beijing's smoky skies, on scarce resources, on food security? What do growing economic disparities in emerging markets mean for political stability, for human security, for migration, for the rise of extremism? How will the shift of economic weights change the current global governance structures? My second point is on the EU implementation of sustainable development goals. You know, last year brought these two milestone agreements, the SDGs in New York and COP21 in Paris. And for us, this 2030 agenda is a universal agreement, and its implementation will require action by all countries, developed and developing, the global north and the global south, underpinned by a global partnership mobilizing governance and stakeholders. We are doing our utmost to make this succeed, and the keyword for this is coherency. We need to ensure that all our actions are in sync to achieve the SDGs, and we are just starting actually a public consultation on the issue of SDG implementation, and I would like to invite all of you who are interested in this issue to make your contribution and to give us your input and thoughts. And my third and last point is the importance of academia. Importance of partnership and connected thinking for us is not to be underestimated. We are aware, of course, that we do not only want to be the biggest donor, we want to be the best and most efficient donor. And for this, we want sound analysis. We need dialogue with partners to benchmark and to share best practices. In these efforts, the academic community, think tanks, independent development experts are, for us, very important partners. The Center for Global Development, which you are chairing, provides exactly what the development community needs to improve further. Rigorous, evidence-based research, bringing together experts and stakeholders to facilitate discussions, detailed reports, and in-depth analysis at the cutting edge in this most fascinating field. So with this, I'm very much looking forward to your words, your explanations, your insights and thoughts, and to the discussion afterwards. Thank you, Mr. Slater.
Well, President Anheier, Ambassador Kühnel, Professor Hartmann, CGD President Nancy Birdsall, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of UNDP's Regional Bureau for Europe and CIS, I would like to welcome you all and thank especially the European Commission, with whom we have co-organized this Kapuscinski lecture series and with whom we are working closely on many key development issues across the globe, be it climate change, be it the Sustainable Development Goals, be it Agenda 2030. I would also like to thank the Hertie School of Governance for hosting this event. This is already the third Kapuscinski lecture that has been hosted here at Hertie, as the president pointed out. And especially, we would like to thank Nancy for accepting our invitation to be a speaker here today. Since 2009, we have organized more than 80 Kapuscinski lectures across Europe. These lectures have stirred debates on development policies and programs in Europe and globally. These lectures, which honor Ryszard Kapuscinski, the Polish writer and journalist who covered developing countries, allow international agencies, such as ours, to confront our work with top thinkers in the field. We don't just do this in isolation. We do it in ways that allow students, the academic community, and the general public to participate in these debates. And these are debates that are shaping the future of global development thinking. In this spirit, I would like to point out that both the audience in this room and those who are watching online can ask questions via Twitter using the hashtag that you see behind me, hashtag capital K-A-P-T, talks hashtag. Today's topic, the middle class in the developing world, is a particularly important one for us in UNDP, especially our regional office for Europe and CIS. This is because we are currently working on a human development report on inequalities in general and what has happened to the middle class in these countries in the 20, 25 years of transition in particular. And we are looking forward with great anticipation to hearing the global results of what is happening to middle classes in developing countries more broadly. So without further ado, it is now my great pleasure to pass the floor to our speaker, President Birdsall. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much to all of you, to the European Commission, the UNDP, and to the Hertie School of Governance for such a warm welcome. I'm particularly pleased to be here at Hertie School of Governance because one of the points I want to be making is about good government. There's a second reason, which is that a graduate of Hertie School, with whom I worked on many of these issues when he was at the Center for Global Development, is here in the audience, Christian. I did look up something about Kapuscinski, and I thought of him and reading about him as the Albert Hirschman of journalists. An amazing life. I think it's a fabulous thing that you have this series of lectures around Europe that is co-hosted in the way this one is. Let me start asking how many of you remember Mohamed Bouazizi? Pretty good. So Mohamed Bouazizi was the man in a southern Tunisian town who was harassed by the police. He had a vegetable cart. That's how he made a living for his family. They were pushing him either for, you know, extorting, or maybe that he was supposed to pay for a license, who knows. And he eventually, he was so frustrated. He had few channels politically to deal with the problems that the police, as predators instead of protectors, were posing. And he set himself on fire, and that triggered the Arab Spring. What's interesting about Mohamed Bouazizi is if you read the newspaper reports, you can see that he was not poor. He was not among what the international community calls the absolute poor. Probably household income in his family was about $5 a day, $4 to $5 a day. The point is, he was certainly not middle class, as I'll say more about afterwards. He lived a life, and his household, his family, lived a life of anxiety and stress. And I will call this group of people that I'll talk about, as well as talking about the middle class, the strugglers. The message that I want to convey is a little bit about a new narrative that we need in the development community. And that is that a way to think about this century's development challenge is to ask, what does it take to move, well, Mohammed had a sister. He was trying to put her through school. What does it take to move Mohammed's sister into the middle class, where she will be protected by the police and have some sense of security? So I'm going to present very quickly two views of development, exaggerating somewhat. Then I'll talk about the middle class, as I'm supposed to, who are they and how do we define them and identify them. And then I want to go back and talk a little bit about this group that Mohammed represents and try to conclude with some ideas about the narrative and some policy implications. I want you to keep Mohammed and his sister in mind as I proceed through the talk. So, two views of development. One view emphasizes people, and we're hearing a lot about this even now in Washington. It's about saving and improving people's lives. It's about basic needs, back to basic needs, something talked about decades ago, health and education in particular. It's about foreign aid as charity to some extent, as redistribution to the poorest people in the world. It's a little bit was embodied in the Millennium Development Goals. And in terms of measurement, it's focused around poverty reduction and the poverty headcount and the poverty gap. That's the view of development focused on people. There's another view, which is focused on systems. And this is the view that puts, say, infrastructure at the top, structural transformation of economies from agriculture to industry, maybe World Bank loans, not foreign aid as redistribution, focus on global rules, injustices, the global system, as we were hearing about a few minutes ago, in an interdependent world, and maybe embodied pretty well in the sustainable development goals. And measured by things like median consumption and income distribution and the expression shared prosperity, which the World Bank has used. There are many great economists who have given Kapuscinski lectures, but two of them are good friends and have been affiliated with CGD, Danny Roderick and Lant Pritchett, and they are all about systems. In contrast, say, to someone like Peter Singer, who was very much about people and redistribution. Now, of course, I'm exaggerating the difference between the two, And the point of having Mohamed Bouazizi at the beginning is that in the end, it's a focus on systems that brings about a focus on people. But I'm doing it in order to sort of give ground to the idea of development in this century being a challenge of building middle-class societies. And that's going to be about institutions and systems. So, who are the middle class in the developing world? Well, traditionally, the middle class was a relative concept between the rich and the poor. But in the last five or more years, development economists have started using an absolute measure of the middle class, a proxy, an income proxy for what is middle class in the developing world. And that absolute measure is defined in dollars, a threshold at the bottom of $10 and up to $50. It's used in the UNDP report that Ben was referring to. So the question is, why $10? And that idea comes from many sources, but I want to emphasize one in particular, which is that work in Latin America by economists tells us something about the probability of falling back into poverty when you're below $10 a day. So below, at $10 a day, people are income secure, relatively speaking, you know. It's a little muddy, of course. So the middle class in Latin America that's above $10 a day is secure against household shocks, a loss of employment, child is sick and has to go to the hospital, that sort of thing. Middle class in Latin America, $10 to $50 a day, pretty much has secondary education, a steady job, not necessarily entrepreneurs, factory and office jobs, pay stub kinds of jobs, access to some social security, to health insurance, and so on. And that's different from the group below, which I'll come back to later, the strugglers, who are, say, if you look at those at $10, at five, let's see, how do we do this? $5 a day here, they have a 50% chance of falling back below $4 a day, back into poverty over the next few years. So they are not income secure. They are not materialist secure in terms of household shocks. So what's happened in the last 25 years since 1990? A period of convergence of developing countries and income towards OECD and rich countries. We know 1 billion people escaped poverty. It's less well known that maybe 900 to a billion people entered the middle class. So I want you to look at the yellow in this slide. The yellow represents the new middle class. The red at the top that you can hardly see is the rich, above $50 per person per day in developing countries. So the blue, which I'll come back to, are the strugglers. And they, both the middle class and the strugglers as a group have doubled in size. More or less, almost doubled in size in the last 25 years because of growth. So that's captured more simply in this picture of the rise of the middle class in the developing world. An interesting factoid is that using data at the World Bank, PovCalNet, many of you may be familiar with it, you can sort out that in urban China in 1990, 1 million people were in the middle class, so defined. In 2015, the estimate is over 300 million people. That's what's happened in China. It's actually quite amazing. So why do we care about this? Back to Aristotle. Take a minute and read what Aristotle said. If you can read it. It's about politics. It's about a state that is well administered when the middle class is large or large enough. So we heard a little bit already why the middle class is a good thing. I'll go through it quickly. It's theory. It's hard to pin it down empirically, which I'll say a little bit more about in a minute. But it's a good thing for the economy because the middle class generates consumption-led growth through demand. It's a good thing for the middle class invests in children, has a low discount rate in economic terms, has aspirations and expectations, so looks to the future. People in the middle class can take reasonable business risks. They can be investors as well as consumers and workers. In terms of economic policy, it's very interesting just to think about it for a minute. The middle class wants predictability and stability. They want a level playing field where they can compete because they are able to compete effectively. They don't want privileges to insiders. That is frustrating for the middle class. They want rule of law and property rights. And I think very important, they have the capacity to pay taxes and a willingness, when government is reasonably effective, to pay taxes to finance collective goods, public goods, roads, schools, security on the part of the police, and so on. So what's happened in the developing world is growth for 25 years pushed people, more people, above that line, that threshold around $10 of income security. And those people are the new middle class. It could set off a virtuous cycle in which growth generates more people in the middle class. More people in the middle class want better government, get better government. Better government implies more sustainable growth. That's the idea. And here's just a little picture from World Value Surveys that where education is the proxy for the middle class in this case. And basically what this shows, say, for participated in a peaceful protest, that people with secondary school are 3 times more likely to do so than people with much less education. So here's another picture of the size of the middle class in the developing world. You see here that it's very closely linked to GDP per capita. Notice how small the middle class is in countries like Ethiopia, Nigeria, even India, one of the BRICS, and how big the middle class has become in places like Brazil, Thailand. The same would be true of Turkey, getting close to 40 to 50%, and Chile, of course. So Mohammed's sister, whom he was trying to get through school, she lives in Tunisia, where the size of the middle class by this crude proxy, the middle class represents about 30% of the population, which, you know, could be kind of a tipping point. Korea went from 30% middle class, more or less, in 1960 to 60% by 1990. And in those years, from 30% to 60%, of course, Korea also became a democracy. Here we see the GDP and the middle class share in another way. And what I want you to look at here is that the association is far from perfect. So in red, you see Uruguay, where there's where per capita income is about $11,000, and it has 50%. Actually, this is old data. It's now more like 60 or 70% of the population at $10 or above. And Venezuela down there with less than 20% of the population in the middle class. This is old. It's probably fallen further in Venezuela. Of course, there's a reason for that. Oil. I'll go back to that in a minute. Let's just talk about how bumpy the road is to becoming a middle class society. So it's one thing to have 30, 40, 50% in the middle class. Does that constitute a middle class society with the kind of resilience in terms of institutions and good government that theory suggests? And of course, we don't really know. But it is interesting that Tunisia, with 35% more or less of its population in the middle class, has the highest of any Arab-speaking country. Egypt only has about 6% of its population in the middle class. And of course, Tunisia is the only country that seems to have, let's hope, survived the Arab Spring, moving in the direction of an open democracy. We don't know. Turkey is interesting, Brazil is interesting. Brazil's particularly interesting because as the middle class grew, support for conditional cash transfers for the famous Bolsa Família was very strong, and indeed support was very strong throughout all of Brazilian society for increasing spending on education and health and those kinds of programs. So there was a kind of social contract built. It was fragile as Brazil's middle class increased. There were also protests in Brazil. It's a form of voice. Those protests were certainly manned by and womaned by students, of course, but middle class people as well. And in Turkey, it was no doubt because there's a large middle class in Istanbul that when the neighborhood park was threatened by development insiders, the middle class went to the streets. So we're talking about resilience, but of course it's not ideal or it's not a guarantee. For one thing, as I mentioned, Venezuela with its oil. The problem with oil is the middle class isn't being taxed and can't use taxes as a tool to make government accountable. The money is easy money flowing in straight to the government because of the natural resource curse that I'm sure you're all familiar with. So same with Russia. Russia has 60-70% of people in this developing world definition of middle class. That's one problem. You know, it's not a guarantee having 30% or more of people in the middle class. Second problem is, you'll remember that I said the middle class people in Latin America, anyway, the evidence is that they're relatively immune to household shocks, but they are not immune to economy-wide shocks that persist. And we are encountering now in the world a period different from the last 25 years for developing countries, likelihood of slow growth. And one thing about the middle class, because of the sense of aspirations is strong and expectations, when there's a growth slowdown or other kind of economic instability, it's bad news. So, you know, the obvious example is Germany in the 30s, when the middle class was hit hard by inflation, among other things, leading to the tragedy of the Nazi movement. And of course, in the US and also in Western Europe today, but in the US we're particularly conscious of it, median wage has not risen. Median household income has been pretty stagnant for many years now. And at the middle class is feeling beleaguered. And at the heart of a lot of the populism and demagoguery that I assume you're reading about in the presidential campaign process in the US is definitely grounded in that sense of disappointment and unrealized expectations. So the problem is that for developing countries, the new middle class is still new. It takes time for the middle class to exert the kind of political force in terms of what economic policy, what taxes should finance. It takes time to build those institutions. And the middle class is still new in the developing world and still fragile. So when is it big enough? I've said a little bit about this already. You see here Tunisia. I'm doing that just to remind you of Mohammed's sister. Maybe Tunisia, it's big enough. You see Brazil, Thailand, and Chile, it's bigger. Now, one way to think about defining a middle-class society has to do with the place of the middle class in the overall economy. So this is a picture of Brazil's distribution of income. And the yellow is, again, the middle class. So you see it's skewed to the right. It's relatively richer. Median income, with these data, this is old 2005 PPPs, but the picture is still reasonably good. Median income was $7 in PPP terms, and the middle class is well above that median. So is it a middle class society? We don't know. We know this country is not a middle class society. This is Tanzania in 2007, and basically the yellow doesn't show up at all. It's there, it's probably in 2007, 2%. People living in the city, civil servants, drivers for NGOs and aid donors, that sort of thing. Median income in Tanzania is only $1. That's very far from even the strugglers in blue that you see there, far below. And here's India, which I just wanted to do because India is one of the BRICS. We think of it as an emerging market economy. It's growing reasonably well now, but it has a long, long way to go before it has whatever the benefits are in terms of resilience and good government that a middle class can provide. Probably there's underestimates of income as you get up, you know, so this might exaggerate a little, but basically India has less than 10% of its population in the middle class. I did work on this with Christian. He can answer any questions about that. And so let's go back to Tunisia. It looks a little bit more like Brazil, obviously, than like Tanzania or India. So that's all about the middle class. Now I want to turn and talk a little bit more about the strugglers. The strugglers are the group between $4 and $10. So let me repeat, these are people that are not poor by the international standard. And in fact, in most countries, the national poverty line, most of the developing countries, the national poverty lines are $4 or below. They're drifting up a little bit in places in Latin America, but parts of Latin America, but it's $4 is of course, well above the $1.90 extreme poverty line and the new $3.10 poverty line that the World Bank has rejiggered given the new purchasing power data. So the point of this picture is to show you that the struggler group is the biggest group in the developing world. And that it's still likely to be the biggest group in 2030. That's based on projections that are country-specific of growth, probably a little bit too optimistic because those projections were, Christian knows more about it. They were set up, they were done 4 or 5 years ago now by a group in France. And assuming no change in income distribution in each country. So they're country-specific, and they give us these kinds of distributions for the developing world as a whole. So we're guessing, you know, in 2030, if we're down to 10% of developing world population as $4 and below, which is in line with the SDG of getting to 3% for extreme poverty, then we'll probably still have 55% of populations in the struggler group, 30% in the middle class, tiny, tiny percentages of the rich. So if you combine the poor and the strugglers, you've got 65% of people still income insecure, still living lives of stress and anxiety. Not anxiety about whether they'll get their paper in at the Hertie School of Government, but anxiety about next week's rent, right? Or how to get children to school if the bus system breaks down. Let me say a little bit about taxes, because I think it's a way to capture the struggle of the strugglers. Let me start by saying the point, in a way, about what I'm talking, what I'm saying is the struggler group doesn't benefit in most developing countries from any of the protections or opportunities that would push many of them, many more of them, into the middle class. And they actually pay a cost. So at least in terms of tax policy is not friendly to the strugglers. This is a picture of the incidence of income taxes and transfers for the struggling group in Brazil. And it's a little complicated, but the green represents direct cash transfers from government to people who are in the struggling group. So it's primarily pensions in countries that have universalized their pension systems, like Brazil. The orange or yellow represents indirect taxes, primarily on consumption. In Brazil, it's not exactly the value-added tax. It's a mess of many other taxes. But in many, many developing countries, there's very high reliance on indirect taxes, especially the value-added tax, which is a good, efficient tax. But it's by its nature regressive because it's a tax on consumption. And the poorer you are, the more of your total income you spend on consumption. So this group in Brazil, their income is reduced by 7%, as you see by the negative blue circled, by the tax burden. There are a lot of other problems with the tax system in Brazil, but this is just to illustrate. We have Mohamed Bouazizi hassled by the police, and we have tax systems in many countries that impose an additional burden on people who are really insecure still. In the Western world, we would certainly consider them poor. So, of course, these people, the strugglers, benefit from health and education services. And there's a lot of talk all the time about health and education services. And that would increase their, maybe get them back up to neutral. So they could be cash poor, but at least they're getting schools and health clinics. However, again, this is from Latin America. I think it's true in India increasingly, in Pakistan, other parts of South Asia. The fact is that these public services are not particularly valued by the strugglers. They, like the middle class, as soon as they can afford it, opt out. So here you see in this picture that the yellow, the middle class, it's actually quite striking. More than 40% of households in the middle class in Brazil send their children to private schools. In the Dominican Republic, it's over 50%. The strugglers also, when they can, by the blue lines you see, will resort to this opting out. So we have a picture, this is very generalized, and I'm using taxes and schooling as sort of indicators more generally of the role of government in the lives of the strugglers compared to the middle class. One last thing on numbers. This picture is meant to remind you how tiny the middle class will be in 2030 in what we now call low-income countries, for the most part. So we have here, well, low and lower middle-income countries in the World Bank classification. So from left to right, it's Ethiopia, Tanzania, Senegal, Kenya, Pakistan, India, and Indonesia. You see how small that yellow is. So we're a long way from having whatever benefits in low-income countries a middle class brings. So while you look at this picture, which combines the poor and the strugglers, and then combines the middle class and rich, you see progress. But what you also see is that in 2030, by these crude estimates or projections, most people in developing countries will still be in the poor and struggling group. So we can salute and cheer a new global middle class in the developing world, but we have to also be aware that there's still a long way to go. And it takes a long time to build the systems and the institutions that the middle class promotes in terms of good government and benefits from. Doesn't happen overnight. So in conclusion, I guess I want to sort of help all of us change the narrative a little bit in terms of what's the big development challenge for the future. From one that focuses solely on reducing poverty to one that focuses in a positive way on building middle-class societies. That implies attending to the strugglers as well as the poor. What does it take to move them, to make them more secure, to secure their rights, to not be harassed? Social insurance issues across the developing world should be higher now on the agenda than ever before. Tax systems that are not only efficient, but reasonable and fair and follow certain principles. Don't tax the poor. And to the extent strugglers are still poor, don't tax them. Let me repeat that in the OECD, people I'm talking about as strugglers would be and are poor. The poverty line in Europe is, in most countries, one half median income. That means it's $20, $25 probably. That's 50 to 100% greater than $10. So development is a long-term challenge. And when you think of it at the country level, I want you to think of Mohammed's sister. Will Tunisia continue to prosper and evolve toward a more open and democratic society? I did want to say something about globalization, because the development challenge today, as was alluded to in the introductions, is both building middle-class societies, and that's something for the development advocates and community and donors to think about more, I think. But it's also about justice and reasonableness at the global level. We have a global system. We have globalization that has many injustices built into it. It's sort of inherently asymmetric. The climate problem is a problem for everybody, but it's far worse for the poor. Pandemics, the risks of pandemic disease, problem for everyone, but much bigger welfare losses associated with being poor in the face of a pandemic. Food security, food price hikes. We don't have enough resources as a development community dedicated to global public goods that deal with climate, energy, forests. The migration problem, the refugee issue. In a way, here in Europe, and in Germany, you're very aware of that. We don't have a global system, a set of rules at the global level that are not only efficient and sensible, but just and fair, particularly for this group of people that I've called the strugglers. It's a good thing that with more educated people, we'll have more awareness of this global interdependence. That's what this picture shows. It considers global warming as a serious problem and has a great deal or quite a lot of confidence in the UN. And this picture shows you that with more education and with growth, many more people are globally connected. And you know that because of the internet and mobile phones and all of that. But the bottom line is still that there's a whole set of issues, and now we go back to what we work on at the Center for Global Development, more specifically, migration, trade, climate, global governance, tax sharing across countries to reduce tax evasion that hurts developing countries, the role of the multilateral banks, underfunded global public goods, the refugee issue. All of these things are about fixing a global system that is not only not working for the poor, it's not working well for at least 55% of people in the developing world. So remember Mohammed and think of his sister. I hope she's finished school, secondary school by now. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Nancy, for this presentation. And before I open the floor to the audience for questions, let me just say how delighted I am that you're with us today and give this lecture, because I must confess I'm actually running a Nancy Birdsall fan club in all of my classes. And I mean, I think most of my students who are here can speak to that. I mean, Nancy's really been an enlightened figure in my generation of development policy practitioners at the World Bank and elsewhere for the subjects she picks up and projects, but also for the way she presents it and lives it. I must confess that I remember you vividly bicycling to Washington from one important meeting to the other and bringing up three children on the same. And I, as of my students, ask me, how did you manage to do all these many things? I said, well, I did them well, but ask Nancy, she did it much better.
That's very nice.
So anyhow, but since I have the privilege of the floor, I also take the privilege of asking you three questions. You don't have to answer them now, you can decide when, and even to answer them not at all. But in your papers, you make very strongly the point that the middle class is indispensable, and it is indispensable for sustainable growth for a number of reasons. You mentioned them in your presentation. Middle class saves, middle class consumes, middle class is civically engaged, middle class sends their children to school, and middle class pays taxes. And you say, and that's my question, middle class is good for good governance. And we development economists say good governance is good for sustainable growth. And then you cite Aristoteles. My question is there any evidence that the middle class, which asks for good governance, actually gets it? Do we have done causal academic relationships which show that if you have a middle class, it actually leads to good governance? Or is that something the Hertie School should pick up and study in their PhD programs? My second question is, and I mean, again, decide whether you want to answer, is in your charts you show you have the grays, you have the blues, you have the yellows, and you have a tiny bit of red. Those are the rich. They're not very important in terms of numbers, but as Mr. Piketty tells us, they're very important in terms of assets. And unless we have some major disturbances globally, these assets will continue to accumulate. Does this asset concentration threaten this notion that the engaged middle class actually is so central to our development, sustainable development process? And lastly, sub-Saharan countries, you show that even by 2030, and in your paper by 2050s, there's a very small middle class. Not sufficiently significant to actually make the change. What is then the development paradigm we should work with in these countries? But before you answer, these are my questions. I was just burning to have the opportunity to once ask them. Why don't we open the floor, take questions, and see how we weave it in? So let me invite you, the audience, to ask, raise questions. Please do briefly, in one sentence, introduce yourself and give me your affiliation.
Good evening, Krista Timels. I'm a PhD student here at the Hertie School and a citizen of a developing country. I was hoping that you could tell us a little bit, maybe a bit more critically, how useful these definitions that you used in your talk still are in this new development paradigm. Because there's a world of difference in developing countries between Brazil and Bolivia Haiti, Indonesia, there's a world of difference between $10 and $50. And so do you see any efforts to use maybe more specific definitions and to deal with this huge variance in these very broad terms and how that can actually help us move forward with the conversation? Thank you.
Let me just collect a few questions. Yes, please.
Hello, thanks for your great talk. Niklas Anzinger, also alumnus at Hertie and work for Dahlia Research, a big data startup. My question is a bit open. I'll be interested if following your work at the center, and there was a lot of new talk about solving the data challenge for developing countries, and I would be curious what you think are new innovative data approaches to get to know, get more insights into the new middle class.
Can we just take one more question there, and then I give it back to you.
Christina Stolte, University of Erlangen-Nürnberg. I specifically work on Brazil, and thanks very much for this interesting talk and lots of examples of the Brazilian rise of the middle class. Brazil is also trying to export its model of fostering a middle class. It's trying to export its Bolsa Familia program that you've mentioned in your talk. And I was wondering how you look on those programs of emerging donors like Brazil. What kind of impact could they maybe have in fostering a middle class in other developing countries? Thanks.
Nancy, before we take more questions, I suggest that you take the floor.
Okay, why don't I start with the questions from the group and then I'll try to say something about your questions. I do think that the very imperfect proxy, where was that question, the first one, somewhere over your right, of $10 to $50 makes sense. It's imperfect, but the point of it is that it allows us to look over time and across countries with something that is fixed. So in that sense, it's like the poverty line, the extreme poverty line of $1.90. Now, it's true that when you get to $1.91, you're still poor. Mm-hmm. And it's true that $10 is far from a perfect proxy. In fact, you know, in Chile, you may not need to be at $10 a day because you have better schools. Mm-hmm. We saw that, at least in terms of demand. You have more social insurance programs. In India, maybe it's lower because the PPP, the data aren't perfect and they don't take into account sufficiently differences in prices across countries. Maybe something about middle class is relative. So if you're in a really poor society in rural India, it doesn't take as much to begin to have the aspirations and hopes for the future that we associate with people who are already reasonably income secure. Still, I think it's useful because it lets us look over time at what's happening to societies. And I think it's also very useful, particularly in thinking about the social contract that develops within societies. So here, let me go back to the Brazilian, the question from, I think you're Brazilian. No, not Brazilian. But the question about Brazil and exporting Bolsa Familia. You know, it's very interesting. You can only have, I think, a successful program like Bolsa Familia in a country where average income, because income distribution is very unequal, average and median income are substantially above the extreme poor. You can support it fiscally. And as it turns out in Brazil, I do think there was support from the middle class because they sensed, at least during the Lula years, not now, for those of you who cover Brazil, but they sensed for the first decade of the 2000s that government was reasonably effective and was doing the right thing on the macro side. And they were enjoying a decade of not having high inflation, etc. So they had a kind of confidence in the government for spending money, not much, you know, because you can target a lot of the poor with relatively small amount of your total fiscal take in a country where average income or median income is relatively high compared to the very poor. That, to me, is an example of how enough people in the middle class, in the right circumstances, both push for good government and then support good government supporting the poor. Can it be exported? Well, in a lot of low-income countries, there's efforts now. The World Bank is supporting efforts in many countries to do cash transfers, not even always conditional cash transfers, but cash transfers. I'm not that optimistic about it, you know. I mean, okay if it's funded from outside, but then how sustainable is it institutionally? It can't be funded in Tanzania from the inside unless something changes dramatically in the way tax systems operate. So it's terrific for many other upper middle income countries and maybe some lower middle income countries. I think the good thing about it is South-South, you know, countries learning from each other. There's no magic best practice or even good practice that comes from the EC in Brussels or the World Bank or whatever in Washington. So the data challenge, I'm really glad you asked that question. We have terrific work at the center on this problem. And I think it's a great example of how the donor system has failed to support statistical offices, census taking, all of the nuts and bolts of having a statistical system in the developing world. Instead, what happens is the people who work, who are a scarce resource in statistical offices in many poor countries, are constantly being contracted, you know, through the government by a donor to do an evaluation of a donor project, or to do, you know, the living standards measurement survey, or do the sampling for this or that. The incentives are all wrong. So we do need a data revolution. I don't know if I'm answering your question, but to me, it's a very interesting example of a public good, even a global public good, that has been underfunded. The donors go for projects, you know, and they're not funding the system, the institutions that provide ultimately the bulwark of good government. So, tough questions. You referred to the middle class, my term indispensable. I think that article had a question mark in its title. I'm not sure. There is not really. There is a little bit of evidence in empirical work. Colleagues at the World Bank, Loiza and Rigolini, we've been updating their regressions at the center. What they did is they asked, does a bigger middle class, can it be associated with better policies? Better social policies, lower tariffs, lower trade taxes, that sort of thing. Better measures of governance of various kinds. And the evidence is there. It's referred to obliquely here. It's not that's, you know, there's endogeneity. It's a virtuous circle. Where does it start? You know, do you have a bigger middle class because you already had some good things? they try to handle that econometrically, and they do get statistically robust effects. It's one study, and the robust effects are not big in magnitude. You know, you get sort of maybe a 10% improvement in social policy, like spending on education, associated with 10% more middle class. That's a lot. Going from 40 to 50% of middle class is a lot. So the evidence isn't there, but I think that we can start developing it now, particularly if we have better fine-tuned measures of what is good governance. I would make a big distinction between government effectiveness and things like, you know, how much corruption is there. The former is what the middle class cares about. Now, of course, they care about corruption if there's an insider privileges that are depriving them of some of their opportunities. So that goes to Piketty and the rich and assets. I mean, the other data revolution we need is the one that Piketty is pushing, which is first distribution of wealth, but even before that, that more countries make available their tax information. Now, the problem is, and I alluded to this, that in most developing countries, there is not very much reliance on the personal income tax, or on corporate taxes, or on taxes on property. So here I have been sort of badgering colleagues at the IMF in the Fiscal Affairs Department. It is not too late to start helping countries develop the institutional framework and systems to get beyond only consumption taxes. Because it's the rich who ought to be paying through personal income taxes. And property taxes. The property tax issue and assets is a very obvious one. I do think, though, that in our discussion in the development community in the last 4 or 5 years about income distribution, the idea of the middle class has not been prominent enough. You know, I live in a country that has very high inequality of assets and income. But some of it is okay. If the middle class were thriving, no problem, even with Wall Street. The phenomenon of Bernie Sanders and maybe some of the Trump phenomenon is all about loss aversion being so great for people in the middle class. So finally, sub-Saharan Africa. What is a development paradigm? Growth. I think it's quite worrying. Productivity levels are low in agriculture in Africa. They haven't really moved that much. Costs are very high for industry. So it's something about not only education, but infrastructure. And something about infrastructure that's managed well to yield high returns. It's a sort of about hydroelectric dams, not just solar lamps, you know? So in the low-income countries that are fragile, we can't, from the development point of view, it's going to take a long time before they have a middle class that holds the government accountable. So donors ought to do everything they can in the meantime to design their efforts in a way that helps citizens see what their government is doing, that makes their governments accountable not to the donors only or mostly, but to their citizens. And that's why I was talking to some of the students earlier about cash on delivery aid, one of my obsessions, which would be that donors would just pay governments for performance that citizens can see and measure and play a role in verifying with their own statistical offices.
Well, thank you, Nancy, for those responses. But let me open the floor again for next round of questions.
Hello, I'm Georg Freis. I'm an MPP student here at the Hertie School. Although your talk, you're very much coming from an economic perspective, I felt that sort of the heart and soul of your talk was really the link between an open and democratic society and the middle class. But if we look at the development in the world in the last decades, we see that a lot of this growth came from China, which is not really a role model in democratic development. And at the same time, if you look at Europe maybe, or the US, maybe the European system with the economic challenges and the political challenges is not as attractive as it used to be. And you already mentioned the US and Bernie Sanders, and maybe some grotesque elements of this political struggle there also reduce the attractiveness of this model. So what would you tell those strugglers in Tanzania? Is really the European or US democratic model better than the Chinese model? Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Roberto.
Hi, Roberto Martinez. I am a PhD student here at the Hertie School of Governance and a research assistant at the European Research Center for Anti-Corruption State Building. And we also look a lot at the importance of engaged citizens and the middle class in promoting good governance and have evidence, for example, that there is a link between higher levels of corruption and brain drain. So meaning that the people that can actually make a difference in the country where they're from also have a higher likelihood of leaving the country and going to places where you were actually mentioning have a better chance. Maybe there's more meritocracy there. Maybe they believe it's easier to actually succeed over there. So do you see this as like brain drain basically as a risk to sustainable development or growth in the long term? Thanks.
Hi, I'm Katarina. I'm from Brazil. I'm actually from Johns Hopkins, recently graduated. My question is, recently the political scenario in Latin America and Brazil has done like a right turn a lot, and a lot of people are being very optimistic about it. And the right side of Brazil and Latin America doesn't like Bolsa Família so much. So do you see this as a threat to the rising middle class in Latin America, or do you think there's enough momentum that it's just going to continue growing?
So I missed a little bit some of what you said in the beginning. What's the threat?
So like the recent elections.
The recent elections.
Yeah, so the right wing is winning a little bit more in Latin America.
Right.
So is that going to affect a lot the growth of the middle class, or do you think there's enough
momentum? Okay. In Argentina and
Brazil a little bit too. The last elections were like right. Very close.
So. Okay. China, you know, I think that let me say two things about the situation in China. First, it has been since the early 90s what I would call China has had for people in their daily lives an effective government that has produced growth. So the urban middle class is the outcome of a lot of good choices that were made at some sort of meta policy level. What's interesting is that this middle class in China is making demands. They don't have political freedom. It's not as attractive a system as democracy, for sure. But they have a lot of economic freedom and have had a lot of economic freedom increasingly over the last 25 years. You know, to start businesses, to borrow, whatever. And at the local level, there's almost certainly more innovation and investment associated with this increase in economic freedom that came with the decision to go move to a market economy. So it's actually quite worrying to see countries like Rwanda, Ethiopia, seeing the Chinese model as the way to do it, that you need a strong, effective state that can afford to deal with democratic longings, particularly in societies that have strong ethnic or religious or other kinds of divisions. I think it's really very worrying. It's the kind of rationale for Museveni staying another round in Uganda and so on and so on. So I guess my answer to your question is that, best said by, you know, the middle class is neither necessary nor sufficient for good government. We know it's not necessary. You can have reasonably effective government that manages to do the right thing at the macro level and sometimes at the micro level as well, generates productivity and growth. And that's Rwanda and that's China. Mm-hmm. And it's certainly not sufficient. We have, as I said, Russia and Venezuela, where you have the oil curse, and we have a history in the Western world where you can have a middle class that's doing reasonably well, and then if there's a really big shock, that's going to be politically destabilizing in one way or another. So there's no magic. It's just that it makes sense that the middle class will demand accountable government, won't pay taxes unless it's getting some response, and that then you generate a virtuous cycle. It can be interrupted by a shock. It may not necessarily produce democracy overnight, but I think a bigger middle class can be associated, and the empirical work is still to be done, right, with creating the institutions and the systems that are more likely to endure when trouble hits. So I think this work on higher corruption and the brain drain is very interesting. I have a colleague at the center who's done a lot of research, amazing research, in different ways to suggest that there ain't no brain drain. Except, and I think your question brought out the exception, when people cannot use their productive skills, they're frustrated. And so if they're living in a society in which corruption is rampant, they'll be more effective somewhere else. And it's not quite right to call it a brain drain, because actually once they go abroad and do well, all kinds of good things can happen. There's remittances, but more important, there's the spread back of ideas. There's a kind of circulation. And those are the people, when a good government arrives in a country that was ridden with corruption, they will be back there in a split second, ready to rebuild. So, you know, a lot of people have left Venezuela. I have many friends, really good economists in Washington and in the US. And if somehow they get over this next terrible hump and manage to find their way back to a democratic government, those people will return very happily. And same, of course, with the Syrian refugees. If war abates and there's no conflict, there is a brain drain right now out of Syria into Europe. Those people will go back, they'll go home, and maybe bring even another round of ideas about how societies operate from their experience in Europe. So the right wing, no, I wouldn't call it the right wing in... You know, I think we exaggerate, those of you who know Latin America, that Lula was the left and Morales is, well, he's kind of the left. But, you know, there's center left and center right. And I think that what we see in a place like Argentina is that the middle class is throwing out the guys that didn't deliver for them. You know, they moved to the center right, and I think in Brazil, who was the candidate who ran against Dilma, right, almost won, and maybe next round, even sooner than the next election, maybe she'll resign. Who knows what? But it's not that it's you know, center left, center right, as in Europe. In middle-class societies in Latin America, is much more like Europe. There's an overall consensus on the boundaries around which societies need to make decisions. And so the middle class is more likely, in the case of a center-left government that's gone too far populist and left, as in Argentina, to want to get back to a center-right approach that returns countries to the market, property rights, data transparency. I don't want to say, you know, that center-right is better than far-left, but I guess I think it is. Not sure it's better than center-left. It depends on the context and the times.
Yes. Okay, go ahead. We take another round of questions.
Well, thank you. Milan Dehn, Head School of Governance, and at the moment working for the Ministry for the Environment in Germany. I think your focus on the middle class also brings with it some kind of moral dilemma, because it avoids the focus on the poor. And you may say, well, they built the system, and then afterwards it kind of trickles down and the poor will benefit from it. But I think there are at least three ways that it actually may hurt the poor. The first is that obviously there's less foreign assistant, foreign academic work on the poor. If your focus becomes the mainstream focus, then a second way may be that the middle classes are known for being terribly afraid of losing their status and of defending their status. And then if they capture the state, they may channel the flow of money in their pockets instead of helping the poor. And then thirdly, you talked about the middle class being more aware of sustainability issues such as climate change. But in Germany, for example, we are pretty conscious of what we do to the climate, but still we have a huge carbon footprint in comparison to developing countries. And climate change obviously hurts the poor the most. So these are three ways that your suggestions may hurt the poor. So I'd just like to see what your solution for this dilemma is.
Hello, I'm Aline Quisera from the HTV School. I'm doing a master in development economics. And my question is, you talked about how taxes are not friendly to the strugglers. And I come from East Africa. And this is, I mean, we are characterized by the strugglers. And our government gets taxes. I mean, they are sustained through the taxes that the strugglers pay. What would be your advice to maybe the donors or also the government to facilitate the strugglers to move from one point to the other? Thank you.
You have a question? My name is Lars Wilke. I'm from the Federal Ministry of Economic Cooperation and Development, the BMZ in Germany. Thanks, Nancy, for the presentation. Actually, it's a good reminder of all the people working in the development field that we should not focus only on the poorest, but also think about how to deal with the strugglers and how to build actually a middle class for a better government or for better governance. My question is related to something that was mentioned at the very beginning about the Sustainable Development Goals and the agreement that was made in New York in September last year. We know that if we look on sustainable development and if we want to raise the income levels of the poorest in the world to the levels that we have, let's say in Europe, we would need the resources of two or three planets. I'm talking about not the financial resources, but about the minerals, about water, and also climate change, and the carbon footprint is related to this. So, what would be your recommendation? How do we come to a sustainable development? How do we build a middle class that is not taking the same or is doing the same mistakes like we in Europe or in the United States, but is developed in a more sustainable way?
Nancy, I hand back to you.
Okay, let me start with the moral dilemma and trickle down. I think these were good questions. It's a little bit like when you talk about non-governmental organizations in Washington. They're the good ones, and then they're the troublesome ones. That sometimes they're so single issue or so focused on one set of problems that they don't see the trade-offs with larger forces of development. So, you know, I would use as an example the war on hydroelectric dams for the last 20, 25 years. but maybe it's unfair to jump to the NGOs. You know, I think, as I said, the middle class is neither necessary nor sufficient. I'm not advocating less work on the poor. I'd say I'm advocating in the development, amongst students of development, I'm advocating more focus on building, on mobility, on opportunities that move people forward. Now, a lot of the work on poverty reduction is the same in many ways. You can say it is about moving people out of poverty. True, and I support all of that. The mission of the Center for Global Development is to reduce poverty and inequality in the world. I guess I'm just calling for a rethinking of the narrative that it's building, not delivering. It's not delivering to the poor, it's building within a society something positive. So yeah, it could be less, middle class can lose its status, sure, in relative terms, and that can create a lot of problems. But what I think is interesting is when there is reasonably good government, the middle class will support that, and they will be more friendly to a social contract that manages to provide opportunities for the poor. It's about the middle class enjoying sufficiently good government that it doesn't want to ally itself with the insider privileges of the rich and wealthy. Mm-hmm. The sort of bad inequality associated with corruption or insider privileges, illegal licenses for forests, whatever. So, you know, that's what it's about. I'll go to the sustainability issue that you raised because that came up again in the last question. So in East Africa, you know, my advice on taxes would be it's time to start dealing with the cadastral survey so that the government has information on who owns what property. I mean, it's not that complicated. In Dar es Salaam or in Nairobi, who owns property that has increased in value substantially in the last 25 years? And is there a system to tax that property? That requires a system. You know, that's hard work. It doesn't happen overnight. But my advice to the countries and to donors would be to work on that kind of system so that the consumption taxes can decline from 70 or 80% of tax revenue to, you know, what is it in Europe? It's 30 to 40% that's generated by value-added taxes. And then you have the benefit that it's fairer. People see that the rich who have a lot of assets and property are paying taxes, and people need to know. That's about transparency. So that would be, you know, in crude summary form, my advice. The SDGs, the footprint problem, water, climate change. Well, I'm an economist, you know. We just have to get the prices right, you know. So I think it is a real challenge. People in the U.S. now, and I assume in Europe, who are feeling kind of stressed. They've been in the middle class, but they're facing, in the U.S., it's a real hollowing out of the middle class in the last 10 or 15 years, especially. They don't want to pay higher prices for gasoline. They don't want to pay. Those in California with the big, you know, farms growing almonds and sort of water-using crops, they've got that privilege locked in, and they don't want to give it up by having to pay much more for the water that they use. But in California, the process is starting now. More people are aware of the problem of climate change. More people are aware of it in California because of drought. Now there's a governor that's bearing down. And I think it's probably going to be supported by the middle class in the sense that if they see that it's the rich that are really using up the resources, then they'll want to see higher prices. I mean, it's just most people in the middle class in the U.S., they're the Congress thinks that they would resist an increase in the gasoline price from 18 cents, where it's been for more than 20 years, to something like what it is in 18 cents a gallon. I don't know, what's that per liter? Anyway, in Europe, taxes on gasoline are much higher. That's what we need. We need to pay scarcity prices for water and clean air. And we have a lot of work at the center on the forestry, the deforestation issue in developing countries. And my own view is that people in Europe and in the US would be willing to pay, if they had a simple channel, they would pay to keep trees standing because they would benefit also from less climate change. But we don't know. We haven't tested the politics. But the fact that two or three or more of you, this question always comes up about the footprint, and it's coming up now, of course, in China. That's a good sign. It's coming up. It's coming up from people who are presumably upper middle class and even better educated than Mohammed's sister, I hope, will be.
Well, thank you, Nancy, and for these your presentation and answering the questions. And let me just sum up with some reflections about what I think this discussion actually means, taking the view of development practitioners over the last 25 years. I think in your writings and your presentation today, you outlined three messages. One is the poor are important, but don't only focus on the poor, as you have done so intensely during a certain period of time. The big progress has been made on those below those poverty lines, but those are very, very poor. But there's a huge group which we call the strugglers, and that's how you termed it, and I think that term has really got some traction. And these people are insecure, and because they are income insecure, and they could fall back into poverty, and they do fall back periodically into poverty, much more than the point estimates say, they behave differently than the middle class. And our task as development policymakers and practitioners is to design policies that those people feel sufficiently secure that they can actually absorb temporary shocks, that they can send their kids to school, that they can start save, that they can start paying taxes, that they can think more medium term and not only short term how to survive tomorrow. That requires a different lens than only focusing on those which are below the absolute or the relative poverty. And your additional point, and very importantly, is there is a middle income group which, because it has different behavioralism, it's A, good for economic growth, because they invest, they save, they invest, they build up human capital, they're active citizens. And because they're active citizens and they benefit also from the public services, they demand better governance. Now, we are somewhat unclear what components of governance they actually demand. And I heard a lot about here democracy here. I think we've got to be careful when we talk about governance in the development sustainable system. It's not only democracy. In fact, one of your figures, you showed how small the middle class in India is. And India is one of the oldest democracies in the developing world, yet it has a very small middle class. So we really, from a research point of view and also from a practitioner point of view, we got to disentangle that governance package and think what are the most relevant aspects for those middle class and how can one support them. That is, in fact, a new agenda, an agenda which I think has actually been adopted widely. The World Bank has rewritten its strategies, other donors too. But I think it's a very, very convincing message, and I think your research has put that very well on the table, has actually labeled it and has drawn points further out, which, you know, we practitioners tend to hurry too quickly, don't think about it. I think it's terrific. Thank you for that, Nancy. And I must say, think going back to your Tunisian, I forgot his name,
Abu Aziz.
Abu Aziz, yeah, and his daughter. My wish is
his sister.
A sister is that his sister not only goes through secondary school, but that she also finds a job in Tunisia on which she then actually can sustain and earn a decent little so she does not fall back into being a struggler. Thank you for joining
us
tonight.
Thank you to all of you. I enjoyed it.